contacted both ladies, Gladys and Martha. Hey, Gladys and Martha, you know that we're opening up at the Cabana, okay? Or the Supremes are opening up at the Cabana, and we need you here, front and center, okay? They looking at him like, nigga, please. Bellas, if you have not already done so, please remember to like, share to Facebook, subscribe, and visit uptopbeauty.com. Today's looky looky will be our gold heart earrings and our Leanna Wood bangles. Ooh. And if you are not already a part of our book club, please remember to hit the Patreon link below and or the join button here on the YouTube, and for a small monthly fee of $5, you babies, yes you, can be privy to all the shenanigans before the YouTube gets it, if the YouTube gets it. Now, let's continue talking about Call Her Miss Ross, the unauthorized biography of Diana Ross, by J. Randy Taraborelli. Okay, y'all okay with that? As a lover, Diana told one of Barry's former girlfriends, "Barry is like nothing I have ever experienced. He's as demanding in our private lives as he is in business." She was never any more specific, but this former girlfriend elaborated in an interview, "He's a terrific lover, but also a mean-minded one, because he uses sex more as a tool to keep a woman in line than as an expression of true love." Ooh, he's the greatest manipulator of all times, and he had Diane eaten out of his hands for years. He became everything to her very quickly. Confidant, father, lover, best friend. He didn't always treat her well, was often cruel to her. But when he did good by her, it was so good that he kept her wanting more, more, and more. She was in a trap, but only she didn't know it at the time. I mean, now that sounds about right.
Y'all,
one time I was messing with this Scorpio. This ninja had me thinking that I loved him, okay? But it was because he was so far in my head. That's why I don't mess with them, okay? That's why I don't mess with them Scorpios. Them Scorpios will make you think that you're in love and you ain't. And the sex wasn't even like that, okay? The sex was like, just as Florence's R situation was overlooked and never dealt with again, Diana's affair with Barry was another taboo subject among the girls. Obviously, the three Supremes really were not the best of friends. Rather, they were just girls from the same neighborhood who sang together and as a result became inextricably tied to one another because of their fame. Mary Wilson still cannot come to terms with the reality of her relationship with her two partners. Flo and I had been parts of Diane's life, and she of ours. For so long now, we weren't just dealing with a friend, but a family member. Mary wrote of this period in her 1986 memoir, Dream Girls. The Supremes became partners in a kind of marriage, each partner seeing the other's flaw but tolerates them because divorce is out of the question and fond memories of the courtship and romance refuse to die. Diana is much more realistic about her relationship with Mary and Flo. Mostly, she doesn't discuss it publicly, and often when she does, it's in a superficial, disingenuous way. But every now and then, a little reality slips out, like in a 1985 interview when she recalled, "I wish I'd had a close relationship with Marion Florence. We would go on stage and sing together, but we never really got deep down inside of how we were feeling, you know? Are you mad at me because I'm the lead singer? Does it make you mad that I sing in front of you?" She concluded, sadly, "We never talked about the heart." July 29th was the night the Supremes would open at the Copacabana after four long months of rehearsals. Every song, every gesture, every word, including Diana's ad-libbed comments, were practiced over and over again. It was a formidable undertaking on Berry Gordy's part to book his girls at the exclusive and prestigious nightclub like the Copacabana, and in the other clubs in which they would play in the next few years, because the majority of these spots rarely featured Black entertainers below the stature of Nat King Cole, Lena Horne, or Sammy Davis Jr. Child, that's a big deal, girl! Let's talk about the Copacabana, okay? So, like I had read previously, you could only be on a certain level in order to get dates at certain clubs, right? And when he was able to wriggle his way around the management at the Copacabana, he was able to see that behind the scenes, there was a lot of criminal activity. There was a lot of affiliation with gangsters, thugs, and the mafia. Okay, this is when he learned this, right? He's aware of this, but he still wants to move forward with bringing the Supremes to the Copacabana. He's willing to take whatever chance he has to get his girls to that level. There were also stories that Berry had gone to investors for capital, and now they wanted to control his company. No one ever had proof. The mafia had also long been rumored to have involvement in the record industry. Believable. Believable. Most nightclub devotees and music fans didn't care who was behind the scenes as long as nothing interfered with their entertainment. Considering the importance of this engagement and all of the pressure on Diana, it was surprising that one of her biggest concerns seemed to be to make certain that Gladys Horton, the lead singer of the Marvelettes, and Martha Reeves of Martha and the Vandellas fully understood the fact that she had finally made it big. Let me tell you what Diana did, okay? Now, I get plenty of comments below talking about some, "Nay, why are you always protecting her?" No, I'm not always protecting her. What I'm doing is, if I agree with what she did, or if I, you know, don't feel like it was done with malice, then I will say so. But if I feel like she's doing something that's out of pocket, I'm gonna speak on it, okay? Like this situation right here. At this point right here, I don't think that what she did was any different from what any other diva did or does, okay? But do I think it's petty and, you know, effed up? Yeah. I'll tell you what Berry Gordy decided to do, okay? He contacted both ladies, Gladys and Martha. "Hey, Gladys and Martha, you know that we're opening up at the Cabana, okay? Or the Supremes are opening up at the Cabana, and we need you here, front and center, okay?" They looking at him like, "Nigga, please." Martha had said, "I got work to do over here. You know you booked me over here, so I ain't gonna be able to do it. You need to find somebody else, because I ain't gonna do it." Martha had herself a legitimate excuse for not going. That goddamn Gladys Horton on the other side, she got gooped. Berry Gordy is just as anxious about the event as Diana Ross. Okay, Diana Ross is like, "And Berry, I need to have them seeing me up there on stage, you know, giving my glory to the world. I want them to see how good I am, that I made it, you know." So Berry, in order to appease Miss Diana, he's like, "I got to get these girls there, okay? I got to get these women in the front row, because Diana want to look down, I'm better than you, you know, at the two ladies, Martha and Gladys. Now, I already told you that Martha was like, "Aunt, no, I can't do it because you booked me over here." Okay. Gladys, on the other hand, she's trying to get out of it because she knows what Diana is doing. Everybody knows what Diana is doing, but she's not going to come out and say, "Barry, I see you. I see you and the bitch. Okay. I know what both you hoes are doing. Okay. But you won't do it to me." When the boss calls you and tells you to do something, you need to do it. Gladys tried to say, "Look, I got an event coming up. I need to rest up. Okay. And I ain't got the proper attire to do all of that." Barry was like, "Don't worry about it. One of my sisters will pick you up, get you this beautiful gown so you can be, you know, presentable or whatever thing, and you're going to sit at the table with me." Gladys Horton recalls, "She dressed me up in a wonderful gold outfit. Really did me up. Then to make sure I didn't change my mind, Barry insisted that I drive to the club with him in his limousine. I didn't understand at all why they wanted me there so badly until she got there." Still dressed only in slips and biting their false fingernails, the Supremes were waiting for Maxine Powers to help them get ready. All of their new gowns selected by Barry's sister, Gwen. Now, behind the scenes, there was a little coup, okay? You know, there was some misunderstandings as to what they was going to wear, who was going to dress them up, who was going to do their makeup, right? But the bottom line was, of course, they looked nice. While they're back there going through that little coup, there's a knock at the door. "Diane, look who's here," he said with a wide grin. He stood aside and Gladys Horton walked in. Diana jumped up. "Barry, you brought her. I just knew you would." She sized up Gladys from head to toe. "Oh my goodness, she looks like a princess," Diana cooed. Then she turned her back on the Marvelette and resumed the business at hand. She never said a word to the visitor. Barry quickly ushered Gladys out of the dressing room. Diana continued her argument with Atkins and Powell because, you know, you got Charlie Atkins there and Maxine Powell, you know, arguing over, well, who's supposed to do what. "Ladies and gentlemen," came the announcement, "Mr. Jules Podell is proud to present the Supremes." The show was an exercise in precision, but it was quickly obvious to the audience that Diana did not consider herself a group member from the way she took the microphone, separated herself from the lineup, and began walking around the stage while performing. Earlier in the day, Barry and his family had buried his sister, Lousie, who had died following a brief illness. After the funeral, he had flown to New York for the opening. As the girls performed "Make Someone Happy," Barry leaned over to Mickey Stevenson and whispered, "She's incredible, isn't she?" "Diana?" Mickey Stevenson said, "Yeah, Diana." So let's remember this, okay? According to the Sugar Ray book, okay, because you know we like to cross-reference, right? According to the Sugar Ray or the Mary Wilson book or whatever book we read, because it seemed like we done read a million right about now, right? And I don't always get things right, you know, because I mean, I can forget some things, you know, but I try my best to remember, okay? So when people be like, "No, Nay, you ain't right. Okay, my bad, I'm human." Now, if I remember correctly, around the time that Lousie died, this is when Sugar Ray had went and stayed with him at his house, okay? Now, I don't recall her mentioning that he, you know, went off to take care of the Supremes at the Copacabana, because she mentioned Diana in passing a lot. I think she dedicated like one chapter to her, you know, but this is around the time that Sugar Ray is laid up in his mansion in California. Okay, so I don't know what the heck is going on. The Gordy family was a close one, and Lousie had been involved with Motown from the very beginning. But this was not a night for sorrow. He turned his attention to the stage once more. "If you don't know us," Diana continued, "on the end is Florence Ballard. She's the quiet one. In the middle is Mary Wilson. She's the sexy one. My name is Diane Ross. I'm the intelligent one." Now, that was a dig. That was a dig, okay? So I ain't gonna sugarcoat that one at all. You know, I don't even understand how Barry let that fly, or, you know, I don't know. They probably was together in a bedroom, kicking and cooing, saying, how else can we be dirty? The girls closed with "You're Nobody Till Somebody Loves You." When she sang "But Gold Won't Bring You Happiness," Florence subtly interjected, "Now, wait a minute, honey. I don't know about that." Wait a minute, honey. I don't know about that. She got that part fucked up. But then Sammy Davis just stood up and shouted, "All right, girl, you tell it like it is." You know Diana and her feelings.
"Well, Mary, why did Sammy Davis Jr. laugh at Florence joke and not mine? I want that joke out."
Now, here we go. The show is over. They backstage. The girl back there getting their roses and, you know, applause. "Oh, Diana, you did wonderful, girl. You did wonderful." Ignoring everyone, Barry walked straight to Diane and whispered something in her ear. Her face lit up. Everyone in the room tried to mask his or her curiosity about what Barry had said to her by acting profoundly disinterested. But all eyes were on the two of them, just the same. He kissed her gently on the cheek and they embraced. "Okay, everyone, listen up." The room quieted. Pencil pens and notebooks quickly replaced glasses of champagne in everyone's hands. "What's up, Chief?" Barry Gordy grinned from ear to ear. "We got things to do."
The morning after the Copacabana triumph, the Supremes were scheduled to pose for publicity photos in the club lobby. They stood in front of a poster with the picture on it and accompanying words, "The Copa Reigns Supremes." After the session, Barry pulled Florence aside. "Not bad, Blondie.
That little line you dropped into the last song," he told her, "really funny stuff." Flo recalled that she wasn't sure if he was complimenting her or being sarcastic. "Diana loved it," he continued. "No, she didn't. No, she didn't. You're a liar." "Oh, she did she?" Florence said. "Yeah, we're going to keep it in the act. Maybe give Mary a line, too. But listen, next time I want you to say..." "Now, you hold it right there, Barry," Florence interrupted him. "My way worked. I'll do it my way, or I'll come up with a new way." "Fine, suit yourself," Barry said. Then he walked away, shaking his head. That night, Diana made the group introductions as she always did. When she said, "On the end, it's Florence Ballard. She's the quiet one." Flo interjected, "Honey, that's what you think." Again, her delivery and timing couldn't have been better. The place erupted in shouts and applause. "All right, Flo, you tell her. That's what she thinks." Diana looked out at Barry in the audience. He wasn't smiling. Neither was she. It was January 17th, 1967, when the Supremes opened at the Rooster Tail nightclub in the heart of Detroit, only 4.5 miles away from the Brewster Projects, but 1,000,000 miles away in experience. At about 22 years of age, each girl was a hometown champ. During this engagement, an interview was scheduled with the reporter for the Detroit News in the Motown offices. The angle, "Hometown Girls Make It Big." It was just another of the many interviews the group had been doing of late. In the middle of the conversation, Diana suddenly announced, "I'd like to say something. I'm going to call myself Diana, not Diane." Florence and Mary were taken aback at the announcement. "I don't understand why. What is the big deal? Diane, nah. What is the big deal? It's an A instead of an E. Why does it matter for?" You know, she could have woke up that morning and was like, "You know what? I am going to change my name to Diana." Even if Florence and Mary had known about it, the way Diana broke the news to the press probably made them feel it was just one more facet of her master plan to separate herself from her singing partners. We'll be right back. Now, if you have not already done so, please remember to like, share to Facebook, subscribe, and visit uptopbeauty.com. Now, remember this. The same people that you meet on the way up will always be the same people that you meet on the way down. My naysayers, my patron loves. You babies, have a good one. You ain't never read a book like this before.